Hello, you're listening to Hibs Talk. I'm your host, as always, Gav. Joining me today is Papa Stu.
How you doing?
And Stephen.
Hello.
How's getting on, guys?
Fine.
Been a long time since we've done that, and obviously me and Stephen a few weeks ago, but Papa Stu's been a while since we've done it in person.
I've actually not seen you for a long time.
I know.
I think maybe a couple of times over the bar.
I watched a game with you recently. I can't remember what Hibs game it was. I came around and watched a game at yours.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's been a while.
I've never seen Steve for a long time.
Ignorance was bliss.
Cup final, probably. Yeah. St. Johnston, cup final.
I've never been in the studio here for I don't know how long.
I know. Aye. Last year, I think.
It'd have been further than back.
2 years, a year and a half ago,
Yeah.
Crazy. Huh. But how you getting on anyway?
Yeah, not bad, doing away.
Aye.
Oh, that's Steve. Aye, not bad. It's Radio Steve.
I know. Yeah, fantastic. So glad to be here.
All boosted up, so that's how we can get together now.
Aye, good. Hopefully it continues for a while. It's a bit scary with all the stuff in the news, but fingers crossed for. So a busy show today. We're going to be having part one, we're going to have a chat about the St. Mirren game. Part two, we're going to be getting into the managerial situation. I know Craig and Liam and Stuart Wilson got into that. If you haven't checked out already, Hibs Talk Extra Time, their episode two of that was kind of on the day that Jack Ross left. But we'll be kind of following, obviously there's been some more developments. We'll be having a chat about the managerial situation in part two, and then finished up with the Dundee game, obviously. So let's just get into the St. Mirren game, guys. Obviously, Sir David's first game in charge, a wet and windy Paisley, not the ideal game for playing conditions. And then the team selection. It looked like you're going to go in a more 4-2-3-1 on Saturday. Murphy starting on the left. Newell and Gogic, the double pivot. Porteous managed to shake off his injury and was able to start alongside McGregor. And Louis and Cadden with the fullbacks, with Doig dropping to the bench. Stephen, obviously a lot of injuries and suspensions, but what was your kind of thoughts when you seen the team?
If David Gray could still play, then I'm sure he probably would have picked his cell in that back lineup, reminiscent of the Scottish Cup team. But it was a change. Obviously, I'm a big fan of the 3-5-2, and seeing them go away from that, I suppose it is what it is. David Gray wants to put his stamp on it, and he did, so I'm assuming that's what he was used to playing under. So.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if he goes back to the 5 tomorrow, Papa Stu, with more defenders to choose from. I mean, he's very, very limited. Like you say, Stephen, he's probably tempted to put his boots on himself.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. I hate seeing this, but I just feel that... When I seen them coming out, and I just don't know, I couldn't get excited about it. McGregor played fantastic today, and it's just, we can talk about the goal later, but he had a great game.
Mm-hmm.
But his hands were tied, to be honest, because he never had anyone, you know, to really choose from.
Yeah.
My surprise was Newell.
Yeah, Newell wearing the captain's armband. What was your thoughts on that when you seen there?
I mean, I'm a big fan of Newell. I think I'm being in the middle of the park as well. That kind of helps with him. I would have expected McGregor to be taking it when he was starting in the lineup. So
we've always said, perhaps too, about needing to move on from the 2016 Scottish Cup final defence and stuff. And I know it's just a little gesture, but I mean, obviously the players are still there. Sort of smashed glass when required with McGregor and stuff. But in terms of cover, but it's maybe giving Newell the captaincy assigned and moving on for that team and not relying on them as much in terms of being leaders and finding leaders elsewhere in the team.
No, I don't get that, because with me, if you need a leader. And he wasn't a leader. He was like Hanlon, what Hanlon's done for the last few years. Hanlon doesn't lead. And don't get me wrong, he's a lovely guy and whatever, but he's not there at the back screaming and shouting and getting everybody motivated at the back, what McGregor would do. Or Porteous. I thought they could have gave it to Porteous.
Mm.
Why not do it? But he's gave it to someone who, to be honest, Neil gets on with his job and passes it left, right, back, forward, down again. I couldn't see it, but they maybe see something. excuse me. They might have seen something different in the changing room.
Yeah.
You know, and think that he's a leader in the changing room. But as Steve says, if you got McGregor coming into that game, into that team, and Porteous still there, why not? I would have given it to Porteous before McGregor as well, because you've got to give him a chance sometime.
I think the problem with that, though, is that, like, Port just needs somebody to lead him through a game.
Yeah.
And I've said that for a while. Obviously, when McGregor plays alongside Porteous, Porteous plays a bit better as well. So maybe that's another contributing factor. Maybe the fact that McGregor's got to do a lot of talking to Porteous. He's not really got the time to spread it around the team. So, yeah, I mean, Newell's probably not the best shout for it. There was other players there, but I suppose he's in the middle of the park. He sees what's going around him, so...
Well, I think the whole captain thing's a wee bit overrated. That's my personal opinion, but it's a talking point, so...
Do what Arsenal do, mate. Have 14 captains.
But yeah, so, like I say, getting on with the game, I thought Hibs started quite well. It was quite encouraging to see that. I thought they kind of started off in the front foot, playing with a wee bit of freedom. Chance 5 minutes in, Nisbet with a header, Josh Campbell on the right-hand side, cut back into his left foot. I mean, it was a very sort of gentle sort of cross in, and Nisbet didn't really find the power on it to trouble the keeper. St Mirren had a few sniffs at goal, but the first half in particular, I thought McGregor and Gogic read the play well. Stuart, you mentioned this earlier, you know, McGregor in particular sort of really shut down off a few St Mirren's almost chances, you know, reading the game well.
He played fantastic, I thought. You know, he was so hard at the back, and as you say, read every ball that came in. He was fantastic, and you know, in the air, that's one thing he's good at. And Gogic did well as well. He broke up play. See, that's another thing. A lot of team fans look at Gogic and they think, oh, what, you know, he's nothing. He doesn't do anything. But all he does is break up play, and he cuts that space down. And he maybe doesn't look as if he's doing anything, but he does.
He just came into a team. It was like Newell in his first season with us. He came back into a team after a long layoff because he wasn't performing, and then he had a job to do, and he done it.
Oh.
Plus, I think, obviously, with Gray being managing that team, it's reminiscent of what Bartley used to come in and do in the team.
Yep.
I think that's probably why Gray's went with him.
Yeah.
25th minute, Boyle on the right-hand side whips in across, bit more pace and a bit more danger on this one, and in comparison with the Campbell one, and Nisbet's header straight at the keeper. Stephen, starting yourself, he's just not really got that clinical touch at the moment, does he?
No, he says it in the podcast last time as well, after the St Johnstone game, he needed to start scoring again, and I thought that he might have picked it up. He was closer a couple of times against Rangers, and then he scored the game after. But he's just not found that purple patch, and until he starts scoring, he's got to need two or three in a game to start getting him rolling, I think.
Yeah, I mean, there was a saying, you know, it was effectively a hat-trick that was just ruled off by bad refereeing decisions. Thought he would be bang on form. Is it encouraging, though, he's getting into these positions?
It is encouraging, but he's got to work on his headers. You know, that was, I hope Dodge would have put a couple of them away, because the ball came over and it's like the keeper, St Mirren keeper, just, you know, one handed caught them.
No.
You know, it was, for a centre forward, you should be putting, and it was pouring with rain, the ground was soaking wet. So why do you know hit the header into the ground so it spins, you know, where the keeper's got to make a save at it? But he's, it was, you know what it was like? It was actually like a good centre half's header back to the keeper.
Can the best solution for a bad header of the ball? Overhead kicks.
Aye. Coming for the centre forward, yeah.
Absolutely not.
Into the second half, though, quite early on in the second half, Hibs had a counter-attack. Murphy picked up the ball in zone half, carried the ball quite a long way into the St Mirren half, about 25 yards out, cutting inside as he did so, and played it out to Boyle. Boyle's cross hit off the defender, falls lovely for Campbell, who smashes in his first goal for the club. Papasio, start with yourself. Thoughts on the goal?
Great for the young lad. To, you know, I think he'll kick on with it. I really do. He's been playing really well. And that goal will get the lad motivated for more. You know, he does make late runs into the box. I think he'll come good with that.
Yeah.
I'm glad for it. I'm really pleased for the laddie.
Yeah, Steve, I mean, recent form, and, you know, he's done well to keep his place in the team. Obviously, the results haven't been going well, but he's been one of the sort of, I mean, in my opinion, anyway, one of the bright sparks of the team recently.
Yeah, 100%. Before the League Cup semi, like, you would never have expected him to be in and around the team, let alone playing every game and getting a good run at it. But his form's been up there. Probably one of the best players in the team now. So, Can't fault him at all. He deserves his space.
You know what it is? He's young and he's trying.
And he's got that 3-2 on his back as well. So.
Aye, that always goes down well with fans as well, the 3-2. But yeah, and then the rest of the game, St Mirren find themselves 1-0 down. So what do? They start working the ball out wide and whipping balls into the box. A few scary moments, a few that lead to corners. And then in the 87th minute, goes out, I believe it's their left back, whips it in. Shaughnessy, the defender, is forward. Nips it out, sort of a wee bit of space in front of McGregor and smashes it past past Macy. Again, too easy from crosses, isn't it?
I felt sorry for McGregor because, as I said earlier, he played really well. But I just think he was getting a bit leggy. A right shitty day. Wind, you know, in your face, the rain, and the park was getting heavier. And, of course, you know, what is it? What age is he? 36, 37? Something like that. 37,
I'll double check. 36, I think.
Something like that. And it was just that... I think he switched off for that second, split second, and he just got in front of him. If that was the first 5 minutes, that would have happened. Yeah. It was just that. And he'll know himself. You know, he'll be kicking himself. But I tell you what, you can't fault him for, you know, just for one little mistake, even though it cost us.
Quite concerning that teams are identifying that as a weakness, and when they need a goal against us, that's what they go to.
Yeah, well, if Hibs picks anything to go by, the fans are anticipating it as well, like, I'll tell you. We're the same at the back. We're crossing every single game, regardless of what time it is in the game as well. There's just players, I don't know if they're caught between playing zonal or man marking or what, but
don't know.
I just kind of get my head around it, and every cross that comes into the ball, you always see the fans putting their head down in their hands and that when it comes in, hoping that it gets deflected out of the 18-yard box. But yeah, it was a goal waiting to happen for me.
Yeah, I mean, overall on the, do you think it was deserved, St Mirren getting a level, or do you think it was did Hibs deserve the win?
It was a shitty game, Gav.
Aye.
You know, St Mirren had their chances, and Hibs didn't really grasp it, did they? You know, we could have got two or three, but we're not taking the chances. So, if you don't take your chances, you can't really say to the opposition, you know, if they're having a couple and then they score, you can't really complain, you know. And getting back to defence, I don't know about you guys, but you know how you watch, and I know we're talking about the Premiership down in England, and they're a lot better players, but do you not think when the ball's getting pushed out wide and they're defending, they've got a strong back four or five, right? They're on a line. You never see them, you know, like zigzagging, you know, and they didn't know where they were. They're always in that line.
Mm.
And when the ball goes out, and you know, I don't know, I notice as well, but wingers in England can take it to the byline and ping their leg round or the foot round the ball, and I don't know how they get it round the right back or the left back. You know how they get that, ping it round, and the centre halves and, you know, the two centre halves are always there in a line, and they're meeting the ball coming across. But we seem to be either getting pulled over to the say if it's coming down the left, we go and we leave Macy on his own. And then our left back, you know, if it's coming down the left, our left back's coming over, and I don't know what it is. What do we do? Do we do zonal? Do we do man to man? I don't know what they do in the training park.
I know. It's going to be interesting to see how they address it, and obviously it's going to be something that the new manager's going to have to address. So let's have a chat about the manager in part two. So as I mentioned earlier, on Thursday's episode of Hibs Talk Extra Time, we had a chat, Craig, Liam and Stuart Wilson had a chat about Jack Ross departing. You can go check that out if you haven't done so already. But obviously there's been some more developments, so we're going to keep the conversation going. And since you guys weren't on that episode, Papa Stu, what was your thoughts when you heard on the Thursday morning that Jack Ross had been sacked?
It was a bit of a shock, to be honest, Gav. But after watching the Livingston match, I called it on the chat, our Hibs Talk chat. I said with his post-match chat with BBC, I just thought he's away, because he's never ever throwing himself under the bus. And he's always back to players, but he turned around and says, it's my fault, no one else's fault. I tell the players what to do, so leave the players. It's me, my fault. And I thought that's awful funny. It's not like Jack Ross. He would turn around and, you know what he always usually says, fine margins. And all that. But he came out and it was like, I'm finished. I thought that, and I said that to the guys, but no many of them sort of said anything. But I just thought that it was a weird post-match chat and interview, and I thought, he's away.
I have to say, it really caught me off guard. I mean, I was talking to the guy that does the STV news bulletins for sport. He was at the press conference today, and I was chatting to him, and it was like, there's never been any questions put to Jack Ross about whether he thought he was under any pressure. Obviously, like, there's pressure, the result's not going away, but in terms of losing his job, that was never even raised as a question. I think everyone just sort of assumed because of the work he'd done last season, and because there was a cup final in 10 days' time, it was not on the cards. And what was your kind of reaction, Stephen, when you seen he was gone?
Like you said, surprise more than anything, especially so close to the cup final as well. The fact is, like, he got us there. He picked a winning team against Rangers, and fair enough, like, league form's not been that great, but everybody goes through peaks and troughs, and I would rather have it at this end of December rather than after the new year when we normally take our dip. Like, we could have picked up. Livy, like, the performances haven't been great, but they've not been great all season, and we've been getting results, and that's what we were asking for at the start of the season. We were asking for winning the crappy games and scraping the 1-0s, 2-1s. I didn't like call the fine margin things and that, but you shouldn't be playing it that way, in my opinion. But that's just me. Like, what's one fan's opinion over the majority?
Yeah, I mean, 2 weeks ago on Hibstock, we talked about that, about his style of playing, about how, you know, fine margins and that sort of stuff. But, like, as much as I wasn't a fan of that style of playing and that approach, it worked. Especially last season, it worked. And then you go into this summer, and this is going to bring us into the recruitment and stuff. Like, I remember doing an interview after, I think it was the Arsenal game, the friendly. I was doing press for that, obviously, because of limited fans and stuff. And I was speaking to him, and I was like, oh, what do you want in the transfer window? And he was like, I want a centre-back and I want a striker. And he made it clear, he wasn't just wanting centre-backs and strikers to come sit on the bench. He was wanting a starter for each position. And he gets, and don't get me wrong, I know he's part of the recruitment team and has signed off these players, but James Scott, an unfit winger from Hull, and I know I put this on Twitter, but the Mega fans will forgive me, and a centre-back from Middlesbrough, like, who went away after one game and played in a 3-0 defeat. I mean, he's been done a bit dirty. Obviously, that doesn't take into consideration injuries to Doidge and other players. Murphy injured for lots of the season. Cadden has had his injuries. It seems a bit harsh, doesn't it?
How much did it pain you to mention Murphy in that list there, Gavin? Could feel the sweat coming down your glasses.
He's injured all the time. We'll never know how good he is. He was all right against Saturday. Let's not get carried away, but he's good on Saturday. Stuart, I mean, has he been done? Am I being too kind to Jack Ross? Which some people did reply on Twitter.
Jack Ross, he's had hard lines. Everything's went against the guy. However, we've got to look at the other sort of way that the fans have been looking at. The football's been pretty poor. It's been boring. You know, you're sitting there, you know yourself. There wasn't this, I hate seeing this because everybody sees it on the TV, high press. We didn't do that. You know, we get Newell in the middle of the park. When does he ever try and play that pass through the two centre, or the centre half and the left back, or the centre half and the right back? When are we ever getting that? Because we're not getting guys behind them. Boyle, you know, he usually has to come shot and then take it on himself. That's we don't play that, you know, under the lat. You know what I was going to say? Sorry. Another thing I was going to say. We done well last year, but we never had any crowd in Easter Road. Now, we weren't playing that great of football. We were churning out results, but you put a full Easter Road in there crying, moaning at the football we were playing at. We were all watching it in our house.
Yeah, that may have had an effect.
You put
as well.
A fan base in Easter Road, watch that, screaming and shouting at the players and Jack Ross. We might have lost because the pressure would have been more severe to the players.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, though, see on the back of that, like, before the game, like, Steve Cowan and Ewan Cameron, our favourite Jambo, they were discussing Jack Ross' departure, and they made the good point, the fact that the players have thrown Jack Ross under the bus as well in the last three games, I think. Since the League Cup semi, I think that the players have just no bothered their arse. I don't think they're happy with the way that they're playing the football. I think that they're not happy with the team selection a lot of the time, and the way that they're being told to play. They're not happy with this whole fine margins thing. And I just think we saw it on Saturday as well. Like, it never got any better. Like, the first half, it seemed fine. We were getting more shots on target and that. But when you've not got strikers scoring goals, and when you've not got the balls being played to the striker, like, it gets boring. And, I mean, from David Gray's post-match press conference, it sounds like he's learned a lot for Jack Ross.
Yeah, aye. I had mentioned in fine margins today, I had a Dundee. I mean, it's one thing, like, I think... I think there was signs. I know we've moved on from Saturday, but I think there was signs. You mentioned the overlap and stuff like that. There was times I thought where Cadden was getting like bombing forward and going on overlap, and just sort of, and it was dragging out the left back, and then it gave Boyle the opportunity to keep the ball a couple of times and have a bit more space. And that's so that maybe there are signs.
It's funny
to come
you
from
say
that
though, Gav, but the last right back that really done that, because McGinn didn't he? But the last right back that did do that was David Gray.
Very true. Very true. David Gray himself.
With Boyle.
Yeah. But I mean, the cup final in 10 days. I mean, Stephen, do you think Jack Ross should have had the final?
100% he should have. Like I says, I mean, he got us there, regardless of the league performances. He got us to the cup final. He deserves to get it. It's 10 days. 10 days before he got sacked.
Is the issue that if they're thinking about sacking him, it's a lot harder to sack him if he wins it?
Correct. And you've got 3-4 games in hand that we're playing, and if we lost in that manner, you know, you're going into a final against Celtic, who, okay, they're not playing that great, however, we're going in to play them, and if we're getting beat and still playing under Jack Ross, the board had to act. I'm sorry, but I understand where Steven's coming from, however, they had to act.
Well, the problem is there though, right? You've just thrown away 2 points against St Mirren away, and we've got Dundee tomorrow. What happens if we don't pick up a result against Dundee? It just nullifies.
Well,
like,
that's
the purpose
what
of sacking.
I understand what you're saying, but if Jack Ross done it, and he's going into a final and he's lost these games that we have lost,
he lost 4 games before we beat Rangers in the semi.
Aye.
I don't know. There's points to both sides, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it's the sort of final thing on Jack Ross. I mean, I think I'm a big fan of longevity in managers, and I think, you know, although Aberdeen fans moaned about the style of play with McInnes, you know, you've seen when a manager like that stuck around, they kind of reap the rewards from that. I think if they have a project, and the fact that, you know, and this is something the boys talked about on Thursday, the fact that all the players were signing new contracts, 3-year contracts and stuff, and then the manager had signed a new 3-year contract, that it seemed to be that they were buying into this project together. And it's a strange one now when all those players are signed a contract. What happens if the new manager comes in and goes by?
Well, you know how you could talk about that with Aberdeen? You're talking about Stephen Glass. They were wanting his head about 4 or 5 weeks ago.
And he got back.
And he's actually turned the corner.
Exactly. So
you know, that's what Stephen's saying. You could, but how long do you wait? I said this the other day when I was, you know, I was on the BBC. But what I was going to say is, how long do you wait? You know, we're too big a club to be in relegation to go down again, because if we go down again, we've got too big a wages.
Yeah. That's an issue.
So we've got a problem.
So, I mean, he is gone now. Best of luck to him. Obviously, unfortunately, it never worked out, but fantastic in this title, especially last season. Delivered us third for the first time. A lot of cup semi-finals. A lot of people say didn't win them, which we obviously said in this podcast. Anyway, but best of luck to him. Let's move on and start talking about who's next. But in terms of that, some reports were sort of saying that, you know, if he was going to be gone if we'd lost to Rangers in the cup and obviously beat Rangers, so that kind of delayed it. And then he was given 3 games after that. So these are just sort of reports. There's a few reports out there. I don't know how legitimate they are. Obviously, some of them are red paper, the red banners and stuff. Anyway, they said that they were judging him on the next 3 games, and that last game being the Livingston one. So to me, if the board were thinking about getting rid of him at Rangers and then we're judging him on the next 3 games where he's lost 1-0, drew with Motherwell at home, and then lost to Livingston.
Right.
Why have they not got somebody lined up?
He beat St Johnson.
That was before. Oh, no, yeah, he beat St Johnson. Yeah, yeah.
So he won won one, drew one, and lost one. Well, lost two, including the Livy game. So I obviously bought another game.
Yeah. But anyway, so regards to that. So what's if they knew that they were thinking of getting rid of him way back at the Rangers game, should a new manager be lined up?
Yeah. Well, I don't see. It's all different in business with football, because if I didn't like the way that you were working in my business and insurance, and I thought, Gav, you're on 3 weeks, you know, I couldn't tell you this, and I went and interviewed people for your job, but unknown to you, because I got caught out with this years ago, right? And then what happens in 3 weeks' time, you've never sort of done any better in the workplace, and I said, right, you're sacked, but I've got somebody lined up. You could take me to the tribunal. So I don't know how it works in football.
We see it all the time. The managers get sacked, and they've got somebody like it was the Wolves manager that was at Spurs got sacked, and it was the same day Conte got hired later in that day.
That's what I'm saying, but it works totally different, and I don't understand it. But yes, getting back to your question, if they've thought, right, Jack Ross had 3 matches to turn it around. Now, let's say he won the whole 3 and he got 9 points. They would have just let it run, and he would have been, he'd have been the manager wanting the team out against Celtic. But he never, and as you say, they should have at least said, right, who are we looking at? Right, we've got 5 potential new managers. Bring it down to 2 and have a wee chat with their agents and have it ready. But can you?
I mean, to me, I don't know. I don't. It gets done everywhere else, so I don't know why Hibs do it. I don't know if it's. I guess it just sort of depends on different approaches. But I mean, especially knowing there's a cup final coming up, to me, I would have been speaking to agents and going, look, we're going to judge our manager on the next game, the Livingston game. So this is early in the Monday. Keep your man free Thursday, Friday for an interview. Like, that's the way I would have done it. And then, like I say, and if Jack Ross wins the game, you cancel the interview. Well, you don't have it down on your emails. Yeah. You just have a chat with the agent. But I don't know. I don't know how it works. Obviously, we don't know. But I think it should have been.
Think about it. You tell the agent. Agents talk, right?
Yeah.
They'll talk.
And then it gets out.
Now, the next manager's going to say, didn't he go with him? They're actually... Jack Ross isn't out the door yet, and they're actually wanting me in.
But it happens in England all the time.
But before the Livy game, there was already talk of Jack Ross being touted for Preston. So, I mean, and then he loses against Livy and he's sacked. So that makes him automatically available.
Yeah.
The fact is, you've got to plan ahead. And obviously, like Gav says, I mean, there's a lot of talk, and you can keep folk available for a few days. The fact is, like, for me, and I'm sure for a lot of people, realistically, David Gray's not our next manager.
No.
What happens if he wins the League Cup?
Aye.
Against Celtic? Does that automatically make him favourite for a manager? I would be getting rid of him as a manager. I think it's far too early for him.
No, he's not ready. He's not ready. No.
So, I mean, looking at the Cup final, obviously you mentioned it there. I think back to Spurs sacked Josie and a caretaker came in. Similar situation to this, Mason, and he was in charge for the Cup final.
Yeah.
Has there been a situation where a permanent manager's first game has been a cup final? Can you think of an example of that? If anybody can think of one at HFC, talk, let us know. I can't think of one off the top of my head. I've been thinking about this question all day. But if not a permanent manager, then probably David Gray. So I had to chat with David Gray earlier on. So here's what he had to say on Eddie May, who obviously has had a caretaker spell twice, and managing Hibs at Easter Road. But first, here's what he had to say when asked if he would be managing the team on Sunday.
I have no idea. The most important thing is tomorrow night, and I know we will be for that. So once that's done, we can then start thinking about moving forward after that. Until then, until anyone tells us any differently, it'll be as it is just now.
Eddie May's someone who's been in the caretaker position before. How has he been having him around the last week?
Obviously, I've known Eddie for a long time now, which is great. He's great to work with, and as you say, he's been in this position before. So he's great for having someone to bounce ideas off, and he's obviously well respected within the football club, and all the boys know him as well. So having someone like that with the experience he's got, it's great for me, and obviously I'm very appreciative of his help.
You've made a lot of memories at Easter Road. How will it feel tomorrow leading the team out as in charge as manager?
Obviously it's not great circumstances when people lose their job for that. On a personal level for me, it's not where I expected to be right now, but at the same time, that's where I find myself. That's the position we're in right now. And it's not about me, it's not about Eddie or anybody else, it's about making sure we get the right result. That is fully what it's about. It's about our job is to get a reaction out of the players to make sure they're ready, to trust in themselves, to stick together, to make sure we prepare ourselves for the game.
So, Sir David, very much focused on tomorrow night, but also sort of not saying he doesn't know whether he'll be in charge on Sunday. Do you think he'll be in charge on Sunday?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, 100%. I think it's far too soon to get somebody else in beforehand.
Yeah, like I say, like we mentioned earlier, we can't think of an example where somebody's been in charge for the first game. It would be strange for an appointment's first game to be a cup final.
Yeah, I think it would just put too much pressure under the players as well, because they would be trying to impress in a final. You know, you've got to be focused on your football. But a new manager would just, I think it'd be too much.
I mean, is there a chance though that Sir David could be in charge for a while? When the statement came out, it mentioned him for the foreseeable future. Obviously, he's saying he doesn't know, and he's just sort of taking it game by game. But we've got 6 games until the winter break, if that's what you can call it, the 3-week break, finishing with a derby on the 3rd of January. Then there's 19 days until the next game. Could that be the time to get the new manager in, give them just under 3 weeks to work with the players, and then their first game would be Cove Rangers in the Cup, and a decent start? You know, could you see, one? I guess this breaks into 2 questions. One, is that an option? And 2, how do you feel about David Gray for 6 weeks?
I would give him until the new year, like until January, but I would have somebody else in. I would give him like the reins at the touchline for the games leading up to Christmas, but we need somebody else in that's going to be able to operate during the transfer window and get their player, well, we say get their players in, unlikely with Hibs, but they need to be able to put their stamp on it. And giving them halfway through a transfer window, David Gray's not got to buy any players. He's not got to be able to identify any players. So unless it's all going through the director of football role as per usual, and the manager's got no say on it whatsoever, then we're going to need a new manager in before the 1st of January.
New managers, well, that'll be the first thing the new manager asks at an interview. He'll be saying, am I getting any money? Am I getting to buy players, or is it you? And to be honest, if I was a manager and I asked the question and they turned around and said, no, you just deal with the football players when they come in, I would nowhere go near Easter Road.
I mean, Jack Ross was very heavily involved in the recruitment process. I mean, he didn't get, obviously, the players that he wanted, but he, in terms of identifying players, it was him, I believe it was him that identified James Scott, which obviously never worked out, but he has been involved in picking transfer targets
past. So. I hope so, for that.
So, I mean, what would you say about, obviously, we've only had one game, what would you say about David Gray for the next 6 games, not 6 weeks, sorry, which I said earlier, 6 games?
You know what it's all about, Gav? It's about the players. Mm. It's not about David Gray. David Gray picks them, and just the same as, you can go back to Jack Ross. Jack Ross told them what to do. They didn't like it. In our opinion, we think that they've chucked them under the bus. But are they going to work for David Gray? Are they going to, you know, go in that park and give everything, you know? Are they going to do it for David Gray?
But how would you feel as a fan if you heard that we weren't getting a new manager until the new year?
I wouldn't be happy, because I think that we need stability, and we've not got it just now.
Mm. The one that talks about longevity with a manager, and keeping David Gray is not a long-term project at Hibs. He's not got to be a long-term manager just now. I think down the line he'll probably come back to Hibs, but we need somebody in as soon as possible that's got to put their stamp on it, get a couple of transfer windows in leading up to next season, and then working with their players.
Thing is, Steve, what you're talking about, we do need somebody in, because it's now the middle of December and we've only got 2 weeks. He's got to come in, this new manager, and find out who he wants and who he doesn't want. If he comes in, say, 3, 4, 5 weeks time, even if he comes just into January, he's never worked with a player, so he doesn't really know if he's good enough or he's not, you know, and what he needs.
Yeah.
So he's really got to work with the players as soon as possible, especially at training, and see if he gets on with them. You didn't get on with them. Tell him to bolt, and then you go and change, and he'll bring in his own players. So I think we need somebody in the next I think before the final, to be honest.
Yeah.
Doesn't have to be in the dugout, Steve says.
Bring back Glenny.
Well, on that, so what we're going to do next is we're going to go through the people that are in the bookies, and then we'll kind of talk about some other ones as well. So I just really want a yes or no, but then at the same time, we'll pick three people that we can talk a wee bit more about. I think Lee Stevens just mentioned the first one that we'll be chatting a bit more. So the first one, the current favorite, or this was yesterday because McBookie's not been great with updating their odds, but this was yesterday. Neil Lennon 2-1. So Stephen, I mean, you just mentioned him there. Are you Lennon or Len out?
Till the end of the season, Lennon in.
What you said about stability.
They can look past. You're the one that talks about longevity. I'm talking about this season. I would get Lennon in. I think he'll be able to prove himself by the end of the season to carry on into next. So for me, Lennon in.
Stuart, how would you react if Lennon came back?
I don't know, because I always feel that someone that comes back to the club, it doesn't work. But I wouldn't mind him. Because, see, you've got to remember about Lennon. Wherever he goes, he's shown it. And I don't know why, but he does well for so long. And I think he gets bored. I don't know if it's just his state affairs, that's how he works. But he seems to get bored with the club that he's at, even at Celtic. I don't know what it is. So maybe it could be good for him to come in and just say, right to the end of the season, that's you. Just your interim manager. This new interim manager's great, isn't it? So bring him in. Just say, do the business till the end of the season. And then we'll get something else. But I don't think for long-term manager.
So Stephen's leaning in. Stuart's a bit more on the fence. I am an absolute no. No, 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 no. The guy was an... I mean, I better not say too much in case I'm interviewing him at the press conferences in a few weeks' time, but nah. It was a mess before, and too much baggage. No, thank you.
It was, Gav. It was a mess.
Yeah.
But the football, now and again, was... No, honestly, see, I was thinking about this last night. Couldn't get to sleep, right? I'm thinking about football, and I'm like, because I really want to speak to Ben Kensel. So if you're listening, Ben, I want to chat with him about something else. However, that 5-5 must have been the best game of football I've seen in actually years.
Yeah, I think it's one of the, like, obviously the cup final's kind of like the exception and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
But other than the cup final, I think it's one of my favourite games of football ever I've been at.
And
it was so fun.
I was right beside the Rangers. I sold my season book seat and moved. And got in right beside them, and I was about 5 yards off of the line, right into the Rangers, and it was the best atmosphere. And that was under Lennon, because he was attack, attack, attack.
Mm. At times.
Even the Kilmarnock game before it, we won 5-2, like, he went for it.
Yeah. Of course, and that's what we miss.
Mm.
Now, you've got to say to the listeners, do you want a Kevin Keegan? Right,
or a Steve Bruce,
you know what I mean? And you ask Newcastle fans, they go for Kevin Keegan all day long.
Mm.
And that's...
Do you want a Sam Allardyce? So that's what I want.
Aye.
But aye, like I say, Lennon's definitely a very sort of controversial one. Obviously, there's three of us here with completely polarizing opinions, so aye, let us know what you think on Lennon. Next one, I think this would be more of a sort of brief yes or no. Derek McInnes?
No.
Nope.
Nah. People moaned about the football under Ross. It'd be worse under McInnes. Steve Keane, next at 5-1.
Never seen him for years. Came out of the blue.
He's been away for too long. And,
yeah.
And he wasn't that brilliant at Blackburn.
No, he actually knows his football, but he might be better upstairs where he is. You know, hopefully. That's maybe his job, you know.
I'd be very apprehensive if he came in. Alex Neil.
Well, everyone's seen him, but I've never seen him play. You know, seen his play through Preston or Norwich a long time ago.
I mean, obviously this is a while back, but I was very impressed with Hamilton's side and what he'd done with Hamilton. And Norwich, obviously, I've seen a bit of them, but I was, like I said, I was under the impression that it was going to be Alex Neil. It was going to be done in a few days, and I started doing some digging, getting ready for stuff for the podcast and stuff, which seems to be a bit premature. But like I say, they were saying about the style of football, talking about his passion, reading some of the articles about him. Aye, that's the guy I want. I'd want if he was willing to come in, and like I say, we're talking about this Derek McInnes 5-6 years sort of like longevity, but with a manager that wants to play the way he wants to play, yeah, Alex Neil's the one for me.
I'd take him. I wouldn't moan about it. Because you know what, these players, if they didn't want to play for him, he'll kick them out the Easter Road himself.
The next one on the list I'll ask you about in the preview and in part three is James McPake, but we'll come back to that. Callum Davidson?
No.
No.
John Carver was 10-1.
Nope.
No. And Ronnie Dyla.
After he stripped. No.
I mean, you talk about passion, you talk about engaging with the fans, the Ronnie roar, the stripping off.
I was actually cringing because there was wee girls there. I'm like, Ronnie, what are you doing, mate?
He does it all the time. He's done it like at the previous clubs he's at. I don't think he's at Celtic, but brilliant. Like doing press ups with MLS Cup. I mean, I think the fact that he won the MLS Cup with New York, living in New York, big money in MLS, I think that's somebody's went, oh, who's somebody that's in America that's got connections with Scotland? But if you're talking about fantasy one, especially if you've got, I mean, I know this is controversial, but John Collins was assistant to Celtic. John Collins, assistant to Ronnie Dyla. Yes, please.
I wouldn't say no.
Some of the other ones, Robbie Fowler.
No.
What is it with ex-Liverpool players that I've never managed thinking, oh, the Hibs job's available, I'm going to get into management? It was Harry Kewell last time. Now it's Robbie Fowler.
But he's managed over in Australia.
Has he?
He's over in Australia.
What's he doing over there?
He was managing...
any good?
Brisbane or something.
He's been managing for about 3-4 years.
Nah.
Sure he has. I hope I'm right now.
I don't know.
He has.
So was Grant Brebner. We'll get him next.
Alan Stubbs obviously been mentioned. David Gray, which we've talked about. And now I put this one on because you guys mentioned it in the group chat organising this. Bob Bradley.
No, Brad Bobley. I mean, I would take him.
He's currently at Toronto FC and 63 years old.
Yeah, nothing wrong with that.
Ex-Swansea manager. Can I just say, there's quite... Like, I mean, I as part of the bald community, I'm quite impressed. Now I'm all for representation. There's a lot of bald men on this list.
Aye. To be fair.
Aye, Steve Keane, Alex Neil, James McPake, Bob Bradley, and I was talking another one as well. There's a few out there. Good to see the Hibs are potentially considering the bald community. I'm all for that.
Go for the long shot, eh? Duncan Mackay. He's what, 100-1 or something?
101 for Duncan Mackay. Love that. But yeah. So I guess the last thing on the management for part two is could it be an outside left field European/American that's not been mentioned?
Possibly. You know, Hibs usually do something different.
Could like Ron Gordon, and obviously there's talk of Ian Gordon being involved, his son. I don't know, that's not been officially announced, but you know, I'm sure he's talking to his son and stuff, and he's apparently got connections. Is that something we could see some American coach we've never heard of?
David Beckham. Nah, Sam Allardyce. That's my point.
I've always said though, you know, it's okay bringing in somebody like that, but it's like toss your coin. You know, Tony Mowbray could have went another way, and we'd have went, who the Tony Mowbray? Who is he? You know, I've never
Terry
heard
Butcher's
of him.
Still available.
Pardon?
Terry Butcher's still available.
Oh, don't. He is. No, it's luck. It's luck involved for a manager to come in and just do it.
Yeah. I seen something on Twitter, somebody saying, I'm sick of seeing these same Scottish names, people that have managed in Scotland, or people have got connections to Hibs. It's time to go left field and go get somebody, like we're talking about, and get somebody. But I can guarantee the same sort of people will be, or other people will be saying in 2 years' time, you know, if that manager didn't work out, oh, it's ridiculous. We've got to get somebody that knows Hibs. It goes both ways. You can spin it both ways.
But, that's what I said, Gab. It's all luck.
Yeah.
You know,
so we'll see.
Left field knows Hibs. Ole Gunnar Solskjaer.
He has managed at
just
at
you
Easter
imagine,
Road.
By yeah. Who you imagine that.
But at the same time, like
good song.
Brilliant song, but if you're talking about style of play, it was the exact same as Jack Ross. Two defensive midfielders passing it between the defence, waiting for the space to go up, but waiting past it from the left hand side to the right hand side. It's the exact same. The exact same tactics.
I bet we're not playing Chelsea.
Anyway, well, if you want Ollie, let us know. But one name we did mention was James McPake, and he will be East Road tomorrow night, so let's have a chat about that in part three. So let's start with the question then, the one we missed off. We've got Dundee tomorrow night. James McPake will be there in the opposition dugout, 6-1 with the bookies yesterday. Do you want James McPake?
Nope.
Nah.
Is that on what he's done at Dundee, or is a bit of still, you know, 2012? I mean, I don't blame him too much for that, but is that, does that play in that, a part in
no,
it?
No, no, I just... listen, he's only new into management. Mm. He's up in Dundee. He's learning his trade. Hibs are too big a team, you know, for him to come into already. And, well, he's never done that great at Dundee.
To be fair, he's drew with us.
Aye, well, that's right. And by the way, this is on a Monday night, listeners. So wait till tomorrow. We could be talking a lot of shite. He could beat us. Mind you, it's another team that's looking for 3 points, so may as well come to Easter Road and take him.
Yeah. I mean, they're a bit all over the place, Dundee, in the recent form. They started the season well and then, like, lost 5-0 to Ross County, lost 4-2 to Celtic. They've lost the last two games, 3-0 to Rangers, 3-2 to Ross County. But, I mean, and most, you know, quite recently as well at home, they've been quite good. They beat Motherwell, who've been flying, 3-0. This league is crazier than now. They beat St Johnstone 1-0. They beat St Mirren 1-0 away, and obviously drew with Hearts at Tynecastle back in October. So, I mean, they're not scoring a lot of goals, but, you know, they're very unpredictable, like we were saying about Motherwell 2 weeks ago.
The league's unpredictable, you know, as you just said, but he's not. And he's an ex-Hibby again, and I just think that, you know, we've done this for years. You know, we
go, two ex-Hibbies banging goals into us the morning.
I know.
We'll come on to them in a sec. But, like, so, I mean, in terms of Dundee, how are you feeling about them tomorrow night? We're getting away from James McPape, but he's not going to be Hibs manager. But what's your thoughts on them this season, and how are you feeling about them tomorrow night?
You know, well, you've got Wee Cummins. He'll be trying like a bear. And if Griffiths comes on, he's not been getting his game.
No.
But, which is weird. But
I am not one to talk, but at the same time, I'm not an athlete. Lee Griffiths is not exactly in peak physical form at the moment.
Yeah, I know. That's a difficult one. Anyway, getting away from Griffiths. Dundee, as you say, but you know, we can go. Forget about. I keep on saying this. Forget about the teams that are coming to us, like the smaller teams.
Mm-hmm.
It's who Hibs turn up. Mm-hmm. If we turn up, we play well. If we didn't turn up, may as well just give them the 3 points, because how many times you go Easter Road and, you know, they're actually running riot.
Yeah.
And I'm like, was it Ross County at home? Was that all they
Ross County away. Away.
It's like, what? It depends on who turns up. And it's an old cliche. It's like, if you turn up, you'll do well.
Yeah.
Hibs have not been turning up for the last couple of months.
Aye. Just finally on Dundee, before we sort of talk about Hibs, in terms of, you know, you mentioned that there's Stephen Griffiths and Cummins, you know, two players that, you know, Cummins obviously scored against us earlier in the season. Griffiths, I mean, I'll probably put a fiver on him scoring, even if he's no in form. One goal in, I think, 11 games or something. Like you say, no getting a start. It's not really kind of turned out the way we thought we would. A lot of people were calling for him back at Hibs when we were signing for a striker, and it's...
Yeah, fucking idiots, I'm telling you.
One of these days, you'll listen to me admit I'm right.
one day, when the podcast is retired. I don't think it's much to worry about with Griffiths, but Cummins, he's always up for a game against us. They've got enough about them. They've beat Motherwell, had a good result against them when they were flying. Like Stuart says, I think it just depends on what Hibs team turn up. So.
Yeah. On Hibs, I mean, selection-wise, the two Pauls are back, Paul McGinn and Paul Hanlon. We spoke about this earlier on. Do you go back to the back five and bring in, you know, keep Cadden, or do you move Cadden to one of the wings, or obviously we've got Murphy and Ball there. How do you set up tomorrow?
Do you bring in Paul McGinn right away? I thought Cadden was absolutely terrific the other day. I thought he was up and down and doing his... You know, but I think it was Joe says, who's this Cadden? Overlapping and... You know, putting the balls into the box.
It's something we've not seen is Cadden play right back in a back four.
Aye, well,
he's played, you know, either on the wing, or he's played wing back on a back five. You know, and he done well right back. It's maybe an option to stick with him.
I'll tell you what, I was annoyed at McGinn against Livingston, because I thought he threw the jersey in, and he had two silly bookings, and... I've seen him going off in it. I don't know what. I couldn't read his body language, and I'm no bad usually seeing that. And I was really appalled at him what he done. That was like amateurish what he done against Livingston, and the same as Paul Hanlon as well. You know, Paul Hanlon. You know, we have to bring
felt
him
guilty
back.
For no getting sent off the first one.
Oh, aye. But it's Paul McGinn, I was really annoyed at Stevie. I really was.
No. I mean, he says you're saying we have to bring in Paul Hanlon, but I mean, you know, is that just because McGregor playing two games in 4 days, or is that because he's our captain and he has to come back in? Would you play Paul Hanlon?
No. I don't know how I would work it, to be honest. I'd maybe move Doig put Stevenson left back
territory.
I was only winding you up. I think Hanlon will come back in. I think it'll be too much for McGregor. You saw him fade in at the end of the St Mirren game. So,
yeah, done well for the first half and the first 60 minutes, but then started to fade.
It is likely. I think it's more likely him starting again than Paul McGinn. But we talk about players that come back for a suspension or whatever and they didn't get in the team. Look at Doig. Hardly getting a game, so I don't know. I'd maybe play three at the back.
I mean, Doig has been playing bounce games in the time that he was suspended and he was getting minutes. I mean, obviously Nisbet's our prized asset, or one of them. But does it get to the point if we're saying earlier he gets into those chances, do we stick with him and hope that he starts scoring, or do we eventually go, well, you're no scoring those chances, so do we start Doig?
Can I ask you a wee question? Because you're always asking us questions. Now, if you're the manager, and this is to you as well, Steve, if you were the manager, you just got named, and it's your first game tomorrow, and you know the whole team, what would you play?
I'd play Doig up top. I'd have a word with Nisbet and say, it's no mean happen for you, son. Put him on the bench. Hopefully that pisses him off. And bring him on when the defenders are tired and he maybe finds a bit more space and he's got a point to prove and put him on with, like, give him like a good 25 minutes or something, but or plan to, and obviously games can change stuff, but yeah, I'd start Doig tomorrow.
What would be your 10 outside?
I like Cadden the right back. I'd bring back Doig. I'd bring in Hanlon again and play Porteous beside him. The double pivot obviously depends on Jake Dalhaes, whether he's fit or not. I'm not convinced that Jake Dalhaes and Newell is working. They got into on Hibstock Extra Time. You can check out that. I'd probably stick with that, and then I'd play Scott Allen behind the striker. As good as Josh Campbell. No, I'd play Josh Campbell beside Jake Dalhaes and play Allen behind the striker. Put Campbell a bit deeper, but
dropping Captain Newell there, Gav.
I know, I've spoken to him. Did I feel bad? Sorry,
Joe. Not happy with that.
Well, you know, I just think that I bet every fan throughout the world thinks this. If they could just go into that changing room, if their players are playing,
I think anything about tactics though. I am so bad at football manager. Gav, everyone tactics. Talks about, I took Hibs to the Champions League. I haven't even won a fucking trophy with Hibs as a football manager.
Gav, all you need to say is, get stuck in, guys. You can't how to play. Come on. How many times do you have to show tactics to fucking players? They're getting paid enough. You tell them, you know, that's where you're playing, and get in there and enjoy yourself. Play with a smile on your face. That's the old cliche. Tell them, play with a smile. So we've got to go in there, and I'd love, how good would it be to if you could just go in and say, right, guys, that's the team. And get out there and let the fans enjoy their night or their day. And they have to enjoy themselves. But the players that are playing there now are not.
Yeah.
And I'm not fussy what anybody says, Steve. Do you think the players are playing to their potential?
Absolutely not.
No.
That's,
So let's say we'll see what team David Gray goes with tomorrow. What's your score predictions for the game?
1-0.
I was going to say that.
You can go as well.
No, I'll go 2-2.
Right.
You're ambitious.
I'm going to go 3-0 Hibs.
I thought you were going to say 3-3.
3-0 Hibs.
What?
Yeah. Aye.
Gav's been drinking.
Gav's actually, he's in with David Gray tomorrow. You've been chatting to him today.
We're going to be Dundee the morning, 3-0. We're going to play brilliant, and we're all going to go, oh my god, we're going to beat Celtic. And we're going to get really carried away, I'll make this week a lot more fun. Speaking of which, a lot of content coming this week, so keep an eye on the YouTube channel. We're getting a few videos up. Speaking to four of the players on Wednesday, including Martin Boyle. So obviously subject to change, but speaking to Martin Boyle and a couple other players. So there'll be player interviews coming up on our YouTube channel. Keep an eye out for that, as well as other content. And obviously the Hibs Talk Extra Time on Thursday. So subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Guys, much planned for the rest of the night? Sorry, it's been a bit later than we'd planned. It's 55 minutes. That's not too bad.
I was planning on getting dinner about an hour ago, but that's not happening.
Nope, not a thing. I'll maybe just go to the bar and have a wee sneaky wee half pint.
Oh, nice. I tell you what, I'm off this week. I may have a drink as well. A wee rum and coke or something.
I'll maybe have a wee Moretti when I go back. Yep.
Aye. I was out for work drinks on Saturday. And because there's a guy leaving, thankfully it wasn't a Christmas do, or it might have been cancelled. But yeah, and we went to another pub. The guys had been drinking lagers, and they're like, "Oh, I'll get a Murphy's," and I was like, "Oh, that must just be another lager. Yeah, just get me one of them."
Oh yeah.
And thankfully, a guy had went out for a smoke, and he's Irish. When he came back, it was like there was a Murphy's there. I was like, "Oh, we got you a Murphy's. Is that all right?" And he's like, "Aye, perfect. I love that." Because right now, if folk don't know, Murphy's is pretty much Guinness.
Aye, Murphy's is beautiful.
Yeah.
But I tell you what, if you had drunk that on top of what you'd been drinking, I thought you were going to get carried him.
So yeah, so when they came back, she was waiting to ask the Irish guy for his order. I was like, no, it's me. I'm not having the Murphy's there. Can I have a Mount Gay and Coke, please? onto the rum and coke, which was much better, and a few whiskies after. It was a good night.
Good night. I've never been to a party this year,
crazy, yeah. Mm. But it was hardly a party. It was four work friends, and it's one of those things where you go to work parties, it's like, I hope we did talk about work. And I'd got there, they'd been there about an hour, because like I said, travelling outside Edinburgh, and they're talking about the work, and I'm like, why are we talking about work? I'm sick of talking about work. I want to talk to you.
Talk about Hibs.
Aye, talk about something outside of work, but yeah. But it was a good night. But yeah. So, like I say, enjoy the final, if we don't get a chance to speak to you beforehand. And like I say, Hibs Talk Extra Time on Thursday, YouTube channel for loads of content as well. Thank you for listening, and we'll be back soon. Cheers.